In this particular code that has been highlighted, the first variable origin will be sorted by ascending order, and based on the values of origin, cylinder values will be in descending order, and based on that, horsepower will be in ascending order.
Okay, based on cylinder
order. Yeah, so it is going to be in a hierarchy. Similarly, here when you give multiple variables in your by statement in proc sort, so the first variable is going to be entirely sorted in a particular order that you specify, that is ascending or descending. Then based on the bunch of values of your make, your mpg underscore city will be sorted. So that is how it's going to happen when you multiple, when you try to sort multiple variables. Okay, yeah. Yeah, so is that clear, Shashi? Did you get some idea about proc sort?
Yeah. But I'm just trying to figure out these last two, the difference between nodupkey and noduprecs, you know?
Yeah. So, Sure. I'll just quickly take you through that. See, what happens in case of nodupkey is when you have a set of, when you have a data set with, like, let's say 10 variables, and 100 observations, and I say nodupkey by a particular variable. Okay, so it will check for duplicate values of that particular variable and eliminate them. So here we are saying by make, right? So here, if there are multiple BMWs in that observation, there are multiple Cadillacs in the observation, there are multiple Mercs, so it will just eliminate all of them and keep only one observation of each
so
make.
Which one is the one? Is it the first?
Nodupkey.
Okay.
Yeah, you're right. It will be the first occurrence of the BMW or whichever is the make.
Okay,
first occurrence of that will be written and the rest of it will be omitted. So that is what happens when you give nodupkey. When you give noduprecs, then the entire record is checked. So the entire record is checked for duplicity. For example, there are two observations which are having the same set of values. So there is a duplicate value basically. There's a duplicate observation.
Okay.
Right? So if we don't want such duplicate observations, then we use noduprecs, wherein the entire observation which is like exactly same, with the same horsepower, with the same invoice value, with the same MSRP, those will be deleted. So when you want to delete duplicate records, then this is the one which you'll be using.
And it has to be always followed by this by all
statement. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes, Arpita?
We can't put any variable over here, like by
It would not, you can put any one variable also, but it would sort it by only that particular variable, that is all. But usually when we are using noduprecs, then it's, you know, underscore all underscore by all variables that we wanted. See, let's just quickly try, see what happens is, let me just copy paste this. As make. Okay, so now I will just put this into a different data set, underscore 3. So I'm just running these two codes. Yeah, you can try it at your end as well and see what the difference is. Yeah, I'm just trying to execute these two codes and figure out what the difference is. Okay.
Yeah, I can see you, what you said. Yeah.
Yeah, so what is the difference?
It's basically the second one, it will check, you know, for the entire variables, the duplication, and we'll just remove it.
Yeah. So let's open the data set. Got the result, Arpita?
Yeah, I got the result. It was showing like for only one values of Acura, Audi, and all the main.
What's happening is just pay attention here. In case of underscore all underscore, the sorting is happening by all variables. Okay, in case of make, the sorting is happening only by make. But when you give noduprecs, then it is going to check for duplicity across variables. Okay, so in this case, here we don't have any such duplicity, so there is no problem, and it is executing very well in both the cases. And then it's not deleting any observations. Got it?
So, Uma, can we mention, you know, specify a set of variables?
Yes, you can.
Which it can, you know, instead of all.
Yeah, you can specify like 3, 4, 5, like make and origin and type, drive terrain and so on and so forth.
So, how it will delete? It will sort first, then delete, or it will, you know, or doesn't matter?
See, what it does is it is going to sort and then omit the records.
Okay. Yeah.
So going ahead, we will be doing further data manipulation, which involves appending and merging data sets. Okay. So, how do we append or merge a data set? First of all, by when you hear these words append and merge, what is the thing that comes to your mind? What do you think is meant by appending? And what is meant by merging?
By CNC or something, like we used to merge two data sets or
Right. That is to club them together.
Club them together, yeah.
Yeah, so what do you think is appending?
To make some difference in the data set, changes in the difference.
No, it's appending is like again clubbing your data sets, but it is like stacking one above the other. It's just stacking data sets one above the other. So you're not dealing with your variables when you're appending. But when you're merging, it is both. It is like a combination of your variables and observations. Okay. So, yes, it is like just you have a data set one, then you just add data set two to it, where basically only the observations are getting grouped together. Okay, so to understand that in a very simple way, let's start with appending. Let's create a very simple data set so that we can see how exactly appending works. Okay. See, I'm using a keyword called cards, other than data lines, but basically both of them do the same job. So even when you give cards other than data lines, it's going to specify that the following lines of code is what has to be read as the input values. So let's just create some data here. Yeah, this is just I'm just creating a sample data set, which is like very small, so that you can understand very well as to what exactly is happening. Okay, so I'm creating two data sets, data DS1 and data DS2, and so that I can use these to append and understand what exactly happens when you're trying to append data sets. Okay, so before
to specify,
sorry.
We have this character variables, right?
Exactly,
So
exactly. So that's what I was about to ask you. Before I execute, can you quickly tell me what is the correction I need to make? So that's good. We'll have to specify the data type of the variable. So let's just run this. Yeah. Yeah, so the two data sets are created in our work library. Let's see what happens when we append. Data sets. So, how do we append data sets? Is using a proc append procedure. Let's see, proc append. We have to specify base equals the base dataset name, so let us say DS1, and data equals the other dataset that we want to append it to, DS2, and run. As you see, we are using a procedure to append the data sets, that is proc append base data set and the data set which goes with the data option. So in this procedure you can append only two data sets, okay? And what do you think is a base data set? Yes, so what is that? That is a data set to which the other data set will be appended. Okay, so it is we have two data sets here, okay? So let's say we have like three or four data sets. So an example is, so this is my base, when I say DS1 is the base data set, so to this data, the data set, the values of my data set 2 will be appended. As in, the values of data set 2 will follow the values of data set 1. And the variables that are there in data set 1 are the ones that are going to be there in a final data set. Okay. So now, which is the data set that is going to look different? As in, which is the data set that is going to have the appended values?
Data set 1.
Correct. So now data set 1 is going to have 7 observations. Am I right?
Mm-hmm.
So let's check the log. So it says data set work.ds1 has 7 observations and 3 variables.
Yeah.
Yeah, pending ds2 to ds1. So let's just check that. Refreshing my work library. Sorry about the disturbance, guys.
That's okay.
Okay, so we have DS1. Yes, please.
I think I ran it the proc append twice. Will it append it like twice?
Yes, yes. As many number of times you run it, those many number of times it will keep appending.
That's why it's showing me like 10.
Yeah, so if you execute it twice, then it's going to append it all over again.
Okay.
Okay? Yeah. So This is how, very simple procedure to append the values, proc append works. But now I'm going to make a very small change here. I'm just going to create another data set which is like very similar to the ones created above. But here I don't want to have a region, but I want to have city. Okay. Now let's say we want to append. We want to create this data set 3 first of all. Once we create it, let's try to append it with data set 2. Alright. Quickly create this data set 3. And let's check. So what is the difference that we have made here? So the two data sets that we are trying to append do not have the same set of variables. Am I right?
Yeah,
so we'll have to check whether we will be able, if we'll be able to append such data sets with different variables. Okay, so this data set has been created. It's got different values.
So you said we'll be appending DS3 onto DS1 now, is it?
Okay, let's, no, before that, let's just try to append DS2 to DS3.
Okay.
Has been created. Let me see. DS3 is my base now, and the data set that I'm trying to append to it is DS2. Let me just run this code. Did you get the result? Anybody? Sure, take it. And guys, take your time and just try and make sure that you're typing the codes rather than copy pasting it, even if they are similar, because that way you will get more used to them. So if you can see my screen, there is an error that I can see.
Yeah,
so what is this error? Let's go to a log window and check it out.
There's no appending.
Yes, done because of enamel is listed above force option to append these files. So what it says, first it says trying to append work.ds2 to ds3. Then it says variable region was not found on base file. The variable will not be added to the base file. Then it says variable city was not found on data file. So it's just listing out the variables that are uncommon between the two files that we are trying to append. So then it says because of mismatch in the variables, there was no appending made, zero observations added. And it's giving us a clue here as to use force option to append these files. So when you have to append two files or two data sets which has got uncommon variables in them, right? So then even in spite of the difference in the couple of variables, you still want to append and check the result. So in that case, what you do is you have to use a force option in your proc append. Got it. So what would happen is, let's say you have, we have this cars data set, right? We have one more data set which has got cars underscore US or something like that. Then it would have all similar values that we have in a cars data set, but there would be a couple of variables missing or different. Right, but you are not bothered about the values that are uncommon, but you just want to append both the data sets and try to do some analysis on the price of the cars and the mileage. Right, so in that case, even if there are certain uncommon or different variables, you would not be bothered much. You are interested in a certain set of variables which are common to both of them. Yeah. And you try to,
yeah.
And you would want to append both of them. But because there are some different variable values, uncommon ones or different set of values, then it will not let you append. You will get the error that you've got now. So in case we want to still go ahead and force append it, we'll have to use a keyword called force in a proc append procedure. Yeah. So you'll have to specify force at the end of the data set. Okay.
So whenever there is a mismatch of variables, then we are able to
force. Yes, yes. But that doesn't mean when you see the result, you'll be able to understand what exactly force does. Yeah, so it's basically giving you a warning that force has been used. So refresh it and open the base file. So which was a base file? DS3 is a?
DS3
is the base file. So let me just open it and check the result. So what would happen in case of force appending is the variables of your base file only are retained. So the variables in a source file were ID, course and city. There was no region. Am I right?
Yeah.
So the region is not going to be included at all. It will just give you ID, course and city, but in case of the others, that is the DS2 dataset does not have city, so it is give you blank values, that is missing values in place of city for those observations which are from dataset 2. Understood?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so in case if you have tried and made dataset 2 as your base dataset, then it would have ID, course and region. Okay. There would be no city. And there would be missing values for the values of region in for those observations of data set 3.
Uh-huh.
So the point... Yes, yes, Arpita, go ahead please. Sorry, Arpita, just one second. Just give me a minute. I will just try and shut the window. Just one second. A lot of disturbance. Yes, Arbita, sorry, you were saying something?
Yeah, I was saying that if you want to include region also,
uh-huh.
then the base data will be different, is it?
Yeah, so if you want to include you cannot, when you're trying to append, you cannot have all four of them. That is ID, course, region and city. So based on whichever is your base data set, the variables of the base data set are only going to be there. Okay, so I'm saying, if you are saying that you want to have a region, then let me say base equals DS2. And then my data would be DS3. And I'll have to still use fours because there are different variable values. So in this case, my resultant data set, that is a base data set DS2, will have ID, course and region, and the observations of DS3. Okay.
Values of,
yeah, it would have blank values for region because there is no region in DS3, right? Yeah, yeah. So that is how your proc append works. So DS3 was my base. Oh, sorry, DS2 was my base, I believe.
So the way it keeps on adding the, you know, more observations as we run the code again and again.
Yeah.
Is there a way, you know, to do the reverse, like keep on deducting, you know, the extra?
You will have to use, you know, because they are repeated values. So if you see here, my DS2 had only three observations, but DS3 had six.
Yeah.
Correct? Yes. Without the region. So there are six observations in from DS3 which do not have the value for region that are being appended. Yeah, you can do that by use. You will have to delete, you know, duplicate records, because they are going to be duplicate records when you just keep appending over and over again. You will have to use a proc sort noduprecs.
Okay, but there is, we are doing merge, you know, or say append DS3 here.
Mm-hmm.
Can I say, you know, demerge, take out?
No, you can't do that. That you will be able to do only when you're trying to merge data sets. So appending is very much confined to stacking observation values one above the other.
Okay,
so when you're trying to merge the data sets, yes, that is what we'll be using most of the times. We won't be using, I mean, real-time append you would not be using as much as you would be using merging data sets. Well, again, that completely depends on the requirement of, you know, what is the objective of the data manipulation that you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so this is about proc append. Okay, now let's come to merging data sets. So, what is meant by merging is just to club together the values of two data sets with all the observations and variables. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So for that, again, let's just create a very simple data set so that it becomes simpler to understand. Yeah, so this is one data set. And the other data set will be DM2, which will have values of ID name and salary. So ID. Just make sure the data values that you're putting in, that is under card statement or data line statement. Just make sure they are the same as the values that I'm putting in here, so that it will be easy to interpret. Yes, please.
Okay. Like if we have age values in a range from like 24 to 30, then we should use the dollar sign, right? Because it will like it has a special character.
Age.
If
it is given as like this, you know, between 24 to, if there's a value like this, then you'll have to do what you're saying.
Then dollar sign should be used.
Yes, right? Yes, yes, correct. Okay, so these are the two data sets that we have created. Let's just run. Have you noted down the data, the values, the data values under data lines or cards? Just keep them similar to the ones that I have here, so that it's easier to interpret the results. So merging datasets is similar to joining datasets. Okay, in SQL and some other languages we call it as joining two datasets. So that is what exactly merge does when in SAS. Okay, we'll see how the code looks like. So how do you merge two data sets is data, the destination file, that is the final destination data set which will have the merged values. Okay, so let me see. DS merge. Okay. Then I use the merge keyword. Alright. Merge the data sets. I have to specify which are the data sets that I want to merge, DM1 and DM2. And when you're trying to merge data sets, you have to always specify which is the variable that you are interested to merge it with, right? So here, if you notice, we have a common variable that is ID, common variable with unique values. So when you don't have a common variable between the two data sets, you cannot merge the data sets. If there was, okay, let's say, if there's no ID here in this case, in second data set, I have only name and salary. I will not be able to merge the data sets DM1 and DM2 because there is no common unique variable that is there.
Mm-hmm.
Right? You will have to have a ID variable or any other variable which is common and for every unique observation. Only then you will be able to merge the data sets. Right? So there has to be something against which it will check and then club it together. So let me just give you a very simple example. Like for instance, if you're using a VLOOKUP in Excel, have you used anytime? I'm sure you would have. So
yeah,
when you're trying to do that, then the variable for which you're going to look up has to be there in both the places, right? So if you're working on two different files, then you cannot look up for something which is not there at the other place. That is the other file.
Yeah.
Right? So similarly, there has to be one common variable, at least one common variable between the two data sets using which you should be able to merge. Right? Therefore, every code wherein you're trying to merge data sets goes with a statement of by statement. Yeah? So by, you specify the variable by which you want to merge the data sets. Right? Okay, in the meantime, I want to make this change. So in my DM3, please make the DM2 dataset, make the change wherein it is 100 and ID is 101, 103, 107 and 105. Just interchange the observation numbers and rerun it before we run the code to merge. Yeah, I say by ID and I complete it with a run statement. So once my DM2 is executed, I will run this code to merge the data sets. Okay, so this dataset has been created and now I'm going to merge DM1 and DM2. Yes, so what is the error? So we have an error here. Let's go to the log and check it out. The error says by variable are not properly sorted on dataset work.dm2. So what it means is wherever and whenever you use a by statement, right, the variable that you're using along with it or the variables that are using along with it have to be sorted first. So that is the reason I asked you to make this change, so that we emphasize on the importance of sorting before using a by statement. Got it? So even when you're working on large data sets and you're trying to merge different file data sets, what you'll have to do is you have to make sure that the variable by which you're trying to merge the data sets has to be sorted. So it is always a good practice to sort the data sets by the variable that you're merging before your merge code. data equals dm2 by id. Yes? So it is not required here in this case, but it's a good practice to do a sorting of the data set dm1 also. I'm just going to write the code, not run it. Okay, so we'll have to sort it by id, and only then we'll be able to use a by id in our merge code. Is it clear as to why did we get the error?
Yeah,
okay.
Understand it, but what is a technical thing, you know, what is going wrong?
See, what is going to happen is, in your data set that you have that we're trying to merge, it will try and check one-on-one values, right? It is going to look for ID 101 and then the name and salary and so on, and then it is going to club them together, merge them together.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it is, when it is going to do that, it is going to do it in an order. So that is the reason you will have to use the variable in a sorted order. Yeah, and by default, not only here, not only in this particular code where you're using a by with merge, further you will see in certain examples, like in proc print, if you're using a by statement, if you're using a by statement in proc means, or anywhere, wherever you use a by statement, the variable that is that you're using with it has to be sorted beforehand.
Okay,
when you're using a by statement, you cannot use a variable that is not sorted in that statement. Okay.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, so wherever you use, so here in this case we are using by with a merge, wherein we are trying to merge data sets. Later you will see, today only we will check that if you are trying to use a by statement in proc print or proc means, even there you will have to make sure it is sorted.
Yeah.
Okay, so now that we have sorted results, then let's just quickly run this and see how the result looks like. Yeah, so before we take a look into the result, any guesses as to how many observations and variables are going to be there in the final data set?
Five observations.
One. Oh, okay. So, how many observations are variables are there?
It has five variables.
Okay, and how many observations?
Five observations.
Yes. So what it is going to do is it is going to take a master list of all the variables between the two data sets. When you're trying to merge, it will just club all the variables together and accordingly stack the observations. So if you see here, I got 101, 102, 103, 105 and 107. As my ID values and the respective age, city, name and salary values. So there are some missing values here. Like there's a missing values in age and city, name and salary. So for 102 ID, there's a missing value for name and salary, and for 105 and 7, there's a missing value for age and city. Why is that? Because in this particular, from this particular data set, these observations do not have age and city value. Hence, they are left blank as missing values. Similarly, 102 ID does not have name and salary. Is that clear?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. So now, this type of merge that we did just now is called as in a merge. So what does inner merge do? It clubs.
Uma, I've got one question here.
Yes, please.
Can you make me the presenter for a sec, please?
Sure. One second. Yes. Yes, please.
Hello.
Yeah.
Yeah. See, I've been running this code now.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, the same thing what we did there.
Mm-hmm.
So it's having 101, 102, 103.
Mm-hmm.
Then you know DM2 I have say 1, 3, 7, and 5.
Correct.
So we did the sorting
on
both DM1 and 2 and say we are merging them by ID.
Correct.
Now what I see in my output, you know, this merged variable, five is missing. Reason.
Oh, okay. Go back to your code.
Yeah.
Open your DM2 dataset. Go to your work library and open your DM2 dataset.
Yeah.
Yeah. So go to your program. I think you probably would have made some changes and then missed out on running it. Rerun the DM2 dataset creation process and then rerun the sorting also.
Okay.
That should help.
Basically, what it did was selected the entire code and ran it. So I'm not sure if
I think probably you just missed out on some patch somewhere.
Okay.
Okay. No, you still don't have it. Go to your program. I'll tell you where the problem is. Just go to your code. Just click on your code. Go to card statement.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What you do is, from the bottom, delete observations values that you have created, 105, 107. Delete the entire thing. From the end, just delete it. No, not the end, just okay. Just 107 and 105. Delete.
Yeah.
Okay, now just type in 107 again. See, what happens is, now next line. Enter. Okay. What happens is, we will see this in detail when we do this chapter or topic called as infiles. Okay, infile statement. That is that's where we'll be discussing in detail as to how do we read raw data. Okay. So what here in this when you're giving trying to read raw data like this using cards or data lines, spacing becomes very important. So you have to give only one space between the variable 1 and the variable 2 and variable 2 and variable 3. okay?
Okay.
And also, there has to be no space at the end of it when you're moving to the next observation. So if there is some issue with the, you know, spacing, then it will not read it properly because it is going to read it in that fashion. Okay, so we will be discussing these things about raw data in detail when we are doing the in-files chapter. Okay, so now try and run this. It should be fine because earlier when we noticed, when we were trying to delete 107 and 105, we noticed there was an extra space in 107 observation. So let's see if this is executed properly. Yeah, so now we have it.
Yeah.
Yeah, great. So I'll just take back the present. And now you can just run your proc sort and your merge.
Sure.
Yeah. Yeah, so what we discussed. Yes, please. Yes, Arpita.
But it is not related to the topic here. I mean, it is related to assignment.
No problem.
So, there in the first question, actually, I copied the things from the observations. I just copied from the that file which we have sent and just on the SAS code. So, and it was not giving the output properly. So is it because of that, this one?
Yes, yes, yes. Yes, it could be. Because there the spacing would be different, no? I mean, it's a Word doc, whichever I've given. If there are some blank spaces or white spaces intermittently, then it will not read properly. So that is one thing that needs to be kept in mind while you're using data lines. So you will have to give one single space between every other variable.
But I tried to remove the space also, but then also maybe I think some variable, maybe code problem or maybe.
I mean, there are the glitches with the currency. There's one variable which has got currency value, right? So that that actually I checked. So you have used it as a character value. So I mean that is okay. So as long as you have used it as a character value and you've given the rest of the values, it should still work. It should not give you an error. You should get it in the same way. Only thing is your currency would be saved as a character value and not as numeric value.
It was giving me some output, but not in that fashion. Like,
okay, not to worry. I will share the right code with you. Okay, so the I'll show you how to deal with the currency value also, and also how the right code looks like. I will share the solution sheet also. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Here, so what we're seeing is this is a how we merge two data sets. And what happens in this particular type of merging is all your variables are put together and all the observations are also merged together. So this type of merge is called as an inner merge in SAS. Okay, here you need to keep in mind the names of the different types of merges are a little different with the usual nomenclature that we have in SQL or any other programming language. So don't bother much with it. You will have to concentrate on the method or what exactly is happening in which type of merge. Okay. So there are different types of merge. So when I mentioned that this is called as inner merge, then we know the different types of merge.
Uma, this merge thing, is it a procedure or?
So what is it? It is a data step. We are not using a proc here, right? It is a data step. Merge is a statement. Okay, so now here we are going to see which are the different types of merges. So the first one what we have checked is a inner merge, right? And let me just list the different types of merges here. And then we have something called as an exact merge. We have right in a merge. Then there is left inner merge, and then we have right outer merge, left outer merge, then there is an outer merge. Okay. So these are the seven different types of merges in SAS. So you've seen how exactly an inner merge looks like. So it goes data, destination, data set name, merge the data sets that you want to merge together by the variable, the common variable between the data sets. That is ID in this case. So that was a simple inner merge. So let's see how do we go about doing exact merge. Okay, data, destination name, DS underscore merge exact. Okay. So I use merge statement and specify the data sets that I want to merge. DM1 and DM2. Alright, by which variable? By ID. Yeah. So before I complete my code, I will have to somehow specify what do I want to do in my exact merge. So exact merge is merging only the common observations between the data sets. Okay. Mm-hmm. See, keep in mind, we are not going to talk about variables. We are when we are talking about types of merge, because no matter which type of merge, all the variables of both the data sets or any number of data sets are going to be there in your final data set. Is that clear? We are talking only about observations in the different types of merges. No matter mm-hmm. which type of merge, you are going to have all the variables of both the data sets. Mm-hmm. It is only the observations that are going to be differing. Okay. So in case of inner merge, what was it? All observations of
both the data sets.
Correct. In exact merge, we are talking about only the common observations between both the data sets. Right. So how do I check if I've got a check for common variables only? So that is, I will use a if statement. Okay, so in order to use a if statement, I'll have to create a intermittent variable, assign a flagging variable for both the data sets by giving in equals x and in equals y. Okay, don't worry much if you're not getting exactly what is happening here. I will explain it to you. Yeah, we will come back to the code and discuss as to what exactly is happening here. Before that, let us just execute it and see how the result looks like. So data, destination, data set name, merge data set 1 and 2, and you will have to give in is equal to x and y. So these are the intermittent variables that we are creating only during the process of execution. These are not going to be created and saved in your data set. These are only for the execution process by ID. Then we give a if condition, if x is equal to 1 and y is equal to 1. Let me just run this code and see how the result looks like, and then come back to deciphering what exactly is x and y.
gave only two observations.
Yeah, so actually how many observations are common between the two? There are only two, right? 101 and 103. There are only two observations that are common between the two data sets that we have created. Oops. Let me just save this. Okay.
Uma, can you just explain me this, you know, how this code is working?
Exactly.
But, into brackets, in equal to x.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll come to that. So, I hope both of you have got the result. So, the final destination data set, that is DS underscore merge underscore exact, will have only two observations that are common between the two data sets. That is with ID 101 and ID 103. Correct?
Yeah.
Okay. So, now coming back to the code as to what exactly is happening here. So, what we are doing is, see here, in a merge statement, we are specifying the dataset names that we are merging, that is DM1 and DM2, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, for both of them, we are just assigning a temporary variable which operates during the process of execution.
Mm.
Okay? How do we assign that? By specifying in equals x, y, it can be anything. It can be any value. A, B, C, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Alright?
Mm-hmm.
So, this is a temporary flagging variable that is being assigned to ID value of DM1.
Mm-hmm.
Correct? See, one thing, whatever we merge, when we are merging data sets, we need to have one common variable. Am I right? At least one common variable by which we are going to merge. Correct?
Mm-hmm.
So, there is ID in DM1 and ID in DM2. Am I right?
Mm-hmm.
Correct? So, how am I going to check both the ID values which are there in two data sets? The name is the same. Both go by the value ID.
Okay, so we are correct? Talking about ith observation.
Not the ith observation. We are talking about ID. See, ID is the variable by which we are merging two data, DM1 and DM2. Is that clear?
Yeah.
Yeah. So now in DM1, what is it called? It is called as ID. In DM2, mm-hmm. What is it called? It is called as ID again.
Yeah.
Yeah. So now I want to check if the ID of DM1 is same as ID of DM2. Am I right?
Mm-hmm.
To check if the value is there, is same as they're common, then both the IDs of DM1 and DM2 have to be the same. Only then it is a common of ID.
Mm-hmm.
Correct? But ID name is the same, but the data sets are different, what I do is I assign a temporary value to DM1 ID and DM2 ID. That is X and Y.
Okay.
So, Uma, for ID, we are assigning X for DM1 ID and
Y for DM2 ID. Okay. This is if you're doing joins or something in SQL, you would say DM1.ID and DM2.ID. Correct?
Mm-hmm.
So, this way, it can differentiate the two different ID values. Am I right? Rather than using this, I am just calling this dm1.id as x and dm1.id as y. dm2.id as y.
Yeah.
Got an idea? So, this is the way I'm just differentiating the two different IDs that I'm going to check to check if the IDs are common or not common.
Mm-hmm.
So by doing that, now and that I've assigned a value, so I'm checking x is equal to 1 is nothing but to check if it is present or not. So here it can hold this statement, it is the same if we can just write if x and y.
Mm-hmm.
You don't even have to write equals to 1.
Okay.
Okay. So here it can take only binomial Boolean values 0 and 1. It can either be 0 or it can either be 1. So it is just to check if it is present or not present.
It is nothing like it is taking from the first observation.
No, nothing. It is just saying, no. You can write it as without what also. You can just write if X and Y. This code also will run perfectly in the same fashion as this is running. So it is just to give a true or false value. So if X is present here, then is Y also present there? So if 101 is there in dataset 1, is 101 also there in dataset 2? That is what we are checking here by this code.
Yeah.
Got it?
Mm-hmm.
So this is how it is going to check for each and every observation and give the result. So by running this code, what it has done is it has encountered only two observations which are there in both the datasets. That is present in both the datasets.
Yeah.
That is 101 and 103. So that is what your X is equal to 1 or Y is equal to 1 is doing.
Mm-hmm.
Is that okay?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Don't worry, you'll be able to make better sense of this when we do the other different merges. Because there your condition will vary and you'll be able to appreciate. Sorry?
Yeah. What is in here like...
In is just to specify in this data set, you know,
okay.
In DM1 for ID assign a value as X. That is how the syntax goes. Okay. So that was about exact merge, and the condition used is X equals 1 and X, Y equals 1, Y equals 1, or you can also mention it as X and Y, correct?
Mm-hmm.
So now let's come to write in our merge. So what is meant by write in our merge is, what is an inner merge? Inner merge is something which has got all the observations of both the data sets, correct?
Mm-hmm.
So when I say a write inner merge, it will have only the data sets of the it will have the observations of only the right hand side data set and not the left hand side.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, data ds underscore write in a merge DM1 specify in equals X and DM2 with in equals Y by ID. I'll have to give my if condition. So if only Y equals 1, run. So you can also write this as if Y. So which is my right data set? The DM2 is my right data set. Can you please run this code and tell me how many observations and variables are there in the final data set? So now when you're saying write in a merge, so is there any difference between ds underscore r inner and dm2? So this is having only the observations of dm2, am I right? 101, 103, 105, and 107. Correct? So what is the difference between this? This ds underscore r inner and dm2 data set?
I think dm2 had 102 as well.
No?
No.
dm2 has 101, 103, 105, and 107 only.
dm2 had three variables.
Yes, that is the difference. DM2 has only three variables, whereas the merge data set has got five variables. Correct? So that is what is the main difference. Similarly, so this is exact merge and this is write in a now we will see what is a left inner. Left inner is nothing but observations of your left hand side data set only. So only this if condition would differ. Change the destination data set name. Yes, please.
Yeah, I have a question. Like you said, it will show only the
yes, please.
It will show only the right, so only the DM2 will be there. DM2 data set.
DM2 observations will be there. See, observations of DM2 data set are going to be there. Okay, it's clear, right? So variables of both are going to be there in any type of a merge that you do. It is only the observations that are going to differ. So in right inner, you are going to have all the observations of your right data set only. In your left inner, you're going to have all the observations of left data set only. Okay, so can you just try this left inner code? So in your condition, you specify x is equal to 1.
So again, even if I mention just if x, if y, that will work, right?
Yes, that will do. So can you tell me what the result is? How many observations are there in the data set? Yes, so it has?
Three
observations. Yes, yes. Yeah. So that is the left inner merge. So what is the right outer merge? A right outer merge is observations uncommon observations of right data set only. Yeah, so what is meant by that is observations which are present in right data set but not in left. Yeah, so this would be our outer So what would be the condition for this look like is if x equals 0, that it should not be present here, and y should be equal to 1, but it should be present in the right hand side. If not x and y, this is how your code will look like. If you don't want to use equal to 0 and 1, you will have to use if not x and y. Have you executed right outer? How many observations are there in the data set?
I'm doing it now.
Uma, can you explain it again?
Yeah. So what happens in right outer is only the observations that are there in right hand side data set, but not in your left hand side data set. So uncommon observations of right data set. So what is meant by that is, see, we have two data sets here, right? DM1 and DM2. So what happened in our inner merge? All the observations were together. So we totally had 101, 102, 103, 105 and 107. Correct. So when we did an exact merge, it picked up only the common observations, that is 101 and 103. These are the only two common observations between the two. And when we did a right inner, it picked up all the observations of my right data set. So 1, 0, 1, 3, 5 and 7. Am I right?
Uh-huh.
And when we did a left inner, it picked up all the observations of the left data set. That is 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 2 and 1, 0, 3. So now we are talking about right outer. So what we are saying about right outer is only those observations which are there in data set 2 but not in 1.
Uh-huh.
So which are the observations that are there in data set 2 but not in 1?
105 and 107.
Yes. So your result will have only two observations, which are, that is, the uncommon observations of your right hand side data set.
Uh-huh.
Okay, observations that are there in 2 but not in 1.
Yeah.
So now what would happen in your left outer merge?
Which are there in first and not in second.
Yes, observations which are there in first but not in second. So how many observations here?
102.
Yeah, there's only one observation, that is 102, which is there in data set 1 but not in data set 2.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yeah.
Yeah, so left outer would be let me clearly write it, observations present in left data set but not in right data set. Okay. Yeah. And how does the condition for that look like? Is this x equal to 0 and y equal to 1. It should not be present in x but should be present only in y. Right, so left outer would be should be present in x but not present in y. Please try these two codes. Let me know once you're done with the execution. Executed the code?
Yeah.
Okay.
I got two errors.
Yes. Okay. Can.
No, I made the same data set actually.
Okay. Yeah, so the right outer set is having two observations.
Yeah, this left outer is giving us two observations, 105 and 107.
That is right outer, right? I'll make you the presenter. Yeah, you have to specify DM2. I think you, by mistake, you've written DM in your merge. Yeah, so it is not able to find the data set. DM2 in both the places. Yeah, and just run it now. Let's view the result. Yeah, so my left outer is having only one observation and five variables. And right outer is having two observations and five variables. Clear?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I will take back the presenter control.
So Omar, is there an easy way to remember? I got confused somewhere.
No, not to worry. The Not to worry, the easy way is to just practice. That is all. So, don't worry, you will not be using all of them at the same time. So, see, what is happening now is we are just trying to learn different types of merges all together at the same time, right? So, when you'll be given, when you'll be given questions to be answered, then logically, when you think you will come, you will be able to decide which is the merge you have to use.
Okay,
let's say for example, you have a data set, one data set which is having customer acquisition details, right? So you have the customer name, the date of acquisition, what is the product sold to so and so customer, and so on and so forth, right? Then there is one more data set which has got product feature details, let's say, and you are asked to merge, okay, find out how many, you know, which customer is you know, what offer or a discount offer is applicable for which customer based on the product. Then when you're given such questions, you'll be able to decide, okay, if this is a question, then I will need to have all the observations on my left hand side and not on the right hand side, so I will have to do a left inner merge, something like this. Right, so when you do that, it'll be simple for you to understand. And as far as these conditions are concerned, if x is equal to 1 and y is equal to 0, this again, you just try and do a couple of codes, merging codes, you will be able to get it intuitively. So it'll be simpler for you to understand and remember.
Yeah,
okay, great, not to worry about that. So what is an outer merge? So you have checked what is a right outer merge and a left outer merge, wherein it will take observations present only in one particular data set and not the other. So an outer merge is nothing but uncommon observations of both data sets. So which are the uncommon observations of both the data sets? So what is meant by this is observations that are present only in one particular data set and not in the other. This is exact, it's opposite of your exact merge. So in your exact merge, it was only the common observations between two data sets. So that was 101 and 103, correct? So now what is going to be the opposite of exact merge? Is the remaining ones, which is nothing but the uncommon observations of both the data sets, that is 102, 105 and 107. Correct? So that is what is meant by uncommon observations of both the data sets. So what is going to be the condition here? If
it's not equal to 1.
Yes, x equal to 0. Should I write and y equal to 0?
Or, okay.
Yes, you're right. So what will happen if I write and x equal to 0 and y equal to 0? Then it will be a blank data set. There will be no observations at all. Right? Which are not present in both of them is nothing. It will be a null data set. So it has to be or. It should be, it should not be there in x, or it should not be there in y. So if you write it like this, it will be if not x or not y. So here your final destination data set will have three observations, am I right?
I just did the and by mistake, Umar. It was showing a null data set.
Yeah, so when you do and, it shows a null data set because there are no observations at all.
So Umar, having understood this, what if you know, it has got a repeated this primary key or...
Yes. So... if you got some repeated value, yes, practically your data is never going to be so clean. You will have to do a lot of processing before you come to the stage of trying to compile your data. right? So yes, if they are repeated values of id, then it will accordingly assign the values of the first value that it encounters. So there it becomes very important which is the data set that you're going to take on your left hand side and the right hand side. Okay, so that is what we'll be going to we'll be checking out in one of our assignments, the next ones, where we'll be working with large data sets on merging the datas.
But all these functions will still work even if you know there are repeated.
Yes, yes, okay. Yes. But it all depends on how what is the output that you're going to get. Right, you'll be able to understand better how exactly is it executing each of these syntaxes or the codes when you have a larger data set and a repeated ID, primary IDs or IDs with a slight different name, difference in the variable names, and how to deal with that. So done with this outer merge? Yeah, so these are different types of merge in SAS, and these are different conditions that we'll be using. So let's just quickly assign the conditions here. So when it is in a merge, there is no condition to be given. In case of exact, it's x equal to 1 and y equal to 1. Right inner is y equal to 1 or
if y
yeah, and left inner is x equal to 1 or if x, right outer is going to be x equal to 0 and y equal to 1, or you can not x if not x and y. Similarly here it's going to be x equal to 1 and y equal to 0, and outer merge is going to be uncommon in both the data sets. So it's going to be x equal to 0 or y equal to 0. So if not x or x or not y. Is this clear? As to what is the difference in each of these different types of merges, how do they merge the observations, and what are the conditions to be given. Okay, so here I will write a very simple piece of code. Can you tell me what this code is doing? Can you please try this code and let me know what is happening here in both these cases. and what? Sorry?
My code it is copying, I think. But I have to just run it.
Yes, yes.
Uma, I'm getting an error message after running the first.
What is it?
It's saying set is not allowed in the data statement.
Can I make you the presenter?
Yeah. Oh, sorry, I think I got it. I think, you know, this. I missed a semicolon.
Semicolon was missing. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, it is creating two data sets, Uma, by the I think it is merging both the data sets, one and it is just copying data set 1 and 2 to destination data set in the first code.
Yes. In the second code also it is the same thing, it is just different data sets.
Yeah.
Yeah, so can I share your screen, Arpita?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, I'm making it a presenter.
We are doing this inner merge, is it?
Yeah, it is something like that only. But the what happens is it is similar to your inner merge without any condition. So here it is just a union of your both the data sets. Here there are no conditions applied. It is not, it is just a union of two data sets, two or more. So it is just going to cluster together all the observations and all the variables together. It is, you can't call it an inner merge. Why can't you call it an inner merge? Because the observations are repeating. They are not being clubbed together. Am I right?
Yeah.
So there is 101, 103. So what this is nothing but more, it is more like appending, but with all variables.
So in a way we
got it.
Using that force, statement.
Yeah.
What
yeah.
We need to do in, okay. So this is more powerful.
Yes. Yeah, if you want to append and you don't want to bother about the variables that are there, you know, mismatch and all that, then you can use this. This is one way of appending, but we cannot simply call it append because it has variables of both the data sets. Got it? It has variables of both the data sets. So only the missing ones will be there and it will just stack all the observations together. You can call it a. Sorry?
Yeah, Uma, but it is not so efficient because it is retaining the duplicate values. So, I mean.
Yeah, so that's what happens in the append also, right? So, this is happening because we have rerun append n number of times on these data set DS1 and DS2 earlier also.
Yeah.
Correct. So, assume there are unique observations in two data sets.
Yeah.
Yeah, assume there is a data set 1 which has got all customers of Bangalore only and data set 2 which has got all customers of Delhi only. So then there are going to be no repeated customers, right, in both the data sets. So we want to append together, but there are a lot of variables which are not the same. So you don't want to get into the hassle of retaining the variables of only one data set and, you know, using a force option and using a proc append. You can just create a union of a data set by just using this code.
Yeah.
So data destination is one data set and you have like any number of source data sets.
Yeah.
Is that clear? So this is what you can call it, an extended append but not a merge.
Okay.
Yeah. So if you can call it a union of data sets. Yeah. Also appending data sets using data and set statement, and not the proc statement, proc append. Is this clear so far?
Yeah.
Yeah. So what we have done today is we have checked out how do we merge and append data sets. So this is again one of the very important functionalities, because when you're working on data sets to pull out certain reports, you will be working extensively on clubbing the data together. Right? Either you'll be trying to append the data sets or you'll be trying to merge the data sets.
Yeah.
Yeah. So this is for today. Okay, please just revise through the different types of merges so that it is fresh and clear in your mind. And let's connect up tomorrow same time. And tomorrow we will be doing quite a few proc procedures, proc steps, like proc means, proc univariate, proc frec, and so on and so forth. Okay, yeah. And before we close the session, I can you extend for 5 to 10 minutes more? Shashi, is it okay with you?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Arpita, can you share your screen with the location where we where you have tried your assignment codes?
Yeah.
Can I make you the presenter?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. We'll just quickly go through it and briefly discuss, and I will share the solution to the assignment today.
Yeah.
Shashi, you can also try how many of questions possible, and then you can refer the solutions.
So you want the solutions or?
No, I want this page. This is the page. You're right. Yeah. So here, Arpita, what you can do is... quantity, batch, unit price, okay.
One more special character is there, like comma.
Yeah, so that is, there is a in format for that. I'll share that to you in the solution. So there is a in format for comma that is called as comma length dot, comma 5 dot, comma 10 dot, or whatever. And since there is a dollar symbol also here, there is a in format called as dollar 10 dot, dollar 12 dot, which comprises of the comma also. So when you're using a dollar length dot, you don't have to use comma because it comes in inbuilt with commas.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So that I will share the solution with you. So this one of the reasons that it wouldn't be running properly is, as we discussed sometime back today, that is the spacing. So after that, you can try and just rewrite the data lines, rather type it out. Then you might be able to get the right result.
Uma, see, I have done this. Okay, this is what I've done. So I typed in the entire set. Okay. And some net stuff, I do know that this thing, mentioning it as the informative format, that's done.
Correct.
But this
correct.
Product ID, something called prod underscore ut underscore one. There, it is particularly asking to mention the number of characters, which I don't understand why I should be doing. Because when I say it is a character variable, I think it should just treat it until the next space, right?
No, that is because when you're reading here, by default, it takes the length of a character variable as 8 characters only.
Okay, that's what it was doing. So I had to
Yeah,
mention a
so
lower
what it will
value.
do, correct, what it will do is by default it will take 8. So by default you will be able to get PROD underscore U T underscore. You will not get 1, 2, 3, 4 after that.
Yeah,
So
that's
by
fine.
default it reads only 8 characters when you specify it as a character variable. So that is the reason. Yeah, Arpita, this is a problem of your spacing. So you will have to re-enter those values without pasting it.
Yeah,
And
because
that should solve it.
yeah, only 3 observations and it should have like 5
Yeah,
characters.
yeah. And they are also not properly assigned to each proper variable. There is a lot of issue with the blank spaces. So try and do that. That should fix it. And I will share the in format for dollar also. Okay? Yeah. And the question 2 was pretty simple. That is done.
Yeah, but I didn't have the ABA one.
No, don't worry. Don't worry about the data set. That is absolutely okay. So you're done with whichever data set you had. That is fine. Yeah, question 2B is also pretty simple. Yes, this was important one. This is just to make sure that you're able to use the if condition properly, right? So based on the condition, you as create a new variable.
Yeah, but here also I didn't got the output, you know, because the DIM data set, it had only in range that what I was asking you, and I didn't get any data set which had only the numeric value
Okay.
for.
No, not to worry, not to worry. As long as you have understood what is to be done, right? As long as you're getting the code, the syntax right, not a problem. I will just output those data sets, that transaction data set, and send it to you so that you can just put it into your folders and use it. But the syntax looks perfectly fine. The destination data set, source file. Hello? Can you hear me just one? Am I audible still? Yeah. Are you able to see my screen yet? Yeah, Arpita? You can hear me, right? Shashi, you're there? Yeah, great. Okay, so that is fine. The syntax looks fine. Else if and the if condition. So the next question is, again, based on the condition, you're supposed to create a output data set. Yeah. So the output data set is being created by using a output statement. If a particular condition is met, then output into a data set name. So when you're doing this, you must keep in mind that you have to specify the different destination data sets in your data statement, as you have rightly done. Right, so there are going to be multiple destination data sets and only one source data set. Yeah. Yes. Can you just open that assignment? Let me just open it and read out the question for you.
Set up the name only variable.
Sorry, can you be a little louder? I'm not able to hear you. Yes, yes, Arpita. Yes, yeah, so it says retain only XYZ data and exclude variables. Yeah, so this is just keep and drop. Yeah. No, not to worry. So it's a keep and drop. I will share the solution and also the extract of the data set that are used here. You can put it in your folder and try it again. And after tomorrow's session, that is after using proc means and other procedures, I will share the next assignment. Okay. No, I will just share the extract of that transactions and sampling data sets. You can just import it using the wizard, or you can just import it by putting it into your folder. Okay, so Shashi, try and solve as many as possible, and then you can just refer the solution. Yeah,
thank you.
Okay, guys, thank you so much. Have a great day. Let's connect up tomorrow, same time.
Yeah, thank you. Bye.
Okay, thanks, Arpita. Thanks, Shashi. Have a good day. Bye.
I'm going to go to the hospital. ಚೆಸ್ಟ್ ಸುಬ್ಬಕ್ಕ ಬಂದಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಪಲ್ಲವಾನ ಶಿಶಿ ಮಂದ್ರೆ ವಾನೆ ಶಿಶಿ ಮಂದ್ರೆ ಶಿಶಿ ಶಿ ಮಾಡ್ರಿ ವಾಲೆ ವಾನ ಬೇಡ ವಾನೆ ಶಿಶಿ ಮಾಡ್ಬಿಟ್ರಿ. ನಿಮ್ಮ ಮನೆ ಬೇರೆ ಮಾತು ಹೋಗೋದು ಒಣ ಹಾಕಿದ್ರು ತಂಗೇವ ಸಂಭವ ಮಾಡ್ಬಿಡಲ ಅವನ
Thank you.